And when we water tobogganed with that boat, you know, it was
fast. Was
it was fun. Yeah, yeah, that added to the fun of it, I guess.
Sure.
And that street address there was my home, 1824 Newark.
Oh, is that right?
And the guy that originated the water toboggan, or, you know, I will say that, he had the water toboggan made of this thicker plywood.
Right.
And so the changes I made.
Thinned it down a little bit there.
I thinned it down so it was cheaper board.
Uh-huh.
And he had handrails that were carved out of a piece of wood with loops, you know, sort of like
hand grip.
And loops. I changed that so it didn't require all that wood machining.
Oh, yeah.
I just used a straight board. And then he had a foam pad on it that was like a normal bedding foam that once water hit it, it just became, you know, soppy.
You know? Sure.
And at that time I was dealing in foam, so I knew about different foams, and this was a foam that was made by Dow.
Oh, yeah.
And it's
water resistant.
Water resistant and doesn't absorb any water.
Sure.
And a very good shock absorber. So anyway, this is what we came up with. This was my model and not the one that the guy originated.
It looks like you still use this from time to time.
We used it when my granddaughters were here. Every year I insist that they take it out once as a
sure.
memorial to me.
There you are.
I had one of Wagemaker's catalogs of the coming year.
Sure.
And they had that on the cover. Did you ever have that?
I don't believe I may have that one. I'll show you the literature I have and we'll see if you remember that
one. Anyway, it was on it was like a two or three page
catalog.
Yeah,
that sounds like one I may have.
And on the cover was the Sea Lark. That was their pride and joy of the coming year.
Yeah.
Anyway, they didn't make it. So, as I understood it, the Grand Rapids plant made the molded ply hull.
Okay.
But they had another plant in Cadillac, Michigan.
Yes.
That started with the fiberglass. And so the top unit of the boat was made in Cadillac.
Okay.
And I don't know if they joined the two together in Grand Rapids or what happened, but that was what I heard.
Oh, yeah.
And
I remember talking to you on the phone at one point years ago, and I thought that you had told me that the man who sold you the motor and had worked for the company remembered them building a particular number. Do you recall anything about that?
I heard somewhere along the line that they had manufactured three.
Okay.
But I had never any proof of that.
Sure.
And I don't know what number mine was.
Mm-hmm.
I know I told this story because I had no evidence of that happening.
I see.
Even Rude had one of these boats at their boat display of the year. When they came out with it. I don't know if they used the original Brooke Stevens boat or whether it was one of the Wagemaker boats.
I have a picture I will show you after a while, which shows one of the Cadillac boats at a boat show with Brooke Stevens and an Evinrude motor on it.
I see.
And I think that That may be the one that they used.
Was it the ply hull or the plank hull?
That was the ply hull. The way this worked originally is that Evinrude Motors hired Brooks Stevens to design a boat that would showcase their new 40-horse Evinrude Lark motor. And they named the boat itself the Evinrude Lark, and it said nothing about Cadillac on it. That particular boat was made by, that was a Century hull that was converted by a company called Carlson Fetter Corporation. And at a cost of $11,000, Evinrude Motors had two of those built. Then they allowed boat companies with the proper credentials to submit their request to produce the boat. And Cadillac Boat Company was selected to produce it. And your number of three sounds very logical to me. I talked to, I sent a letter to Oliver Wagemaker III.
Hmm.
And I received a reply back.
Did he live in Grand Rapids?
I believe so. I received a reply back from him, and I have that with me that I'll show you after a bit. And he said that he didn't know if that boat was ever really produced. He said he didn't really see them around. He thought they might have made one for the literature, but that it wasn't anything common in any way. And he said if I ever encountered one to let him know. At this point, we've seen two. I have one, and Bill Anderson has one that he only recently acquired. Of course, I have yours. And I think that in looking at your boat, my sort of gut feeling is that it's probably the last one that they made. The one that Bill Anderson has aluminum castings at the edge of the windshield, which are used as footsteps. And you'll remember those on your boat. They had a lot of little round hemispherical dimples in them.
Where were they?
They were right at the edge of the windshield.
Where the windshield came in.
Yeah.
The little slot where it
Yes, that's exactly the part. Now, I noticed on your boat, those are made out of fiberglass. But on Bill's boat, and presumably on the Evinrude boats, that was aluminum.
I see.
And also on your boat, it was built with a bench seat. And Bill's boat has a split kind of bucket seat arrangement, which is closer to the Evinrude boat.
Yeah.
And that makes me feel that yours perhaps was later production or the last one, because I'm thinking they did the fiberglass so they wouldn't have to pay a foundry to make those parts. Okay. That made it less expensive.
Yeah.
And also the seat being a bench allowed for three people instead of two.
Yeah.
And that would make it more practical. So I think it was a refinement, just as you refined the water toboggan. I think they were refining your boat.
Mm-hmm.
So I have a feeling it may have been the last one made.
Do you got the motor from Steve?
I do have
you?
The motor, yes. Steve was kind enough to
let me have
that. Oh, I know, and I was so sorry.
Yeah.
That's been a couple of years now, I understand.
Yeah.
I felt very fortunate to have become a part of the history of that particular boat,
and
it will certainly be cared for.
Yeah.